We begin the hour with a countdown and new chaos caused by President Trump. Morning tweets attacking his own chief of staff and then, remarkably, attacking the temporary spending plan crafted by his own party's congressional leaders. You see the clock right there on the screen. Inside 36 hours now until the government runs out of money. 7 hours or so until the House votes on a stopgap measure crafted by Speaker Paul Ryan, a Republican, a measure that includes an attempted olive branch to Democrats, funding for a popular children's health care program. Bad idea, the president says, or tweets. Chip, the president tweeted this morning, should be part of a long-term solution, not a 30-day or short-term extension. Mark their speaker down, trust me, as furious. But don't expect him to say that with the cameras rolling.
I am sure where he stands. He fully supports passing this legislation. I just talked to him about an hour and a half ago after my CSIS speech. So I didn't see what he wrote, but I've spoken with the president. He fully supports passing what we're bringing to the floor today.
Compare the speaker's diplomacy to this, the Senate's number two Republican, John Cornyn's reaction when he was asked to respond to the president's latest tweet, this from Fox News.
Well, I'm not sure what the president means.
A lot of that going around today. Let's get straight to CNN's Phil Mattingly up on Capitol Hill. Phil, you were in the room with the speaker after giving a little Big Ten poke. You asked him how effective President Trump has been as a partner. What'd he tell you?
Yeah, look, I think you kind of nailed it on the head. The speaker's very diplomatic about this. Right now, I think it was more confusion than anything else when it came to the tweet this morning. I had several Republican aides text me and say, hey, have you heard anything from the White House that explains what he actually meant by this tweet? They weren't sure if it meant the duration of the CHIP program, if it meant the duration of the short-term funding bill. It was mostly just confusion. Now, the speaker explained this away by saying, look, I spoke to him on the phone. This is essentially a repeat of what's becoming a regular thing. This happened last week on the FISA vote you mentioned. The speaker gets on the phone with the president shortly after the tweet. They have a discussion about things. After that, the speaker comes out publicly and say, hey, everything's good. He understands where we are. He's completely supportive of our position. I think the biggest issue right now is, and this is what I asked the speaker about, this is a very close vote in the House. Republicans are going to have to carry the weight on this. They need the votes on their own, and they have a lot of members who are very uneasy about this process. The president weighing in like this on this issue isn't helpful. Then you look over in the Senate and everything that's going on right there. The fact that this was a deliberate strategy by Senate Republicans to try and draw Democrats in or make it a very painful vote if they voted no, the president calling that into question, it's not helpful when you talk to aides. Will it sink the process entirely? No, but it certainly throws a wrench in things on a very difficult day, John.
Phil, test one is the House tonight, and if the CR passes, it changes everything. But the Senate has to make preparations. The majority leader has to make preparations in case we get to the point of a shutdown. What's the plan?
Yeah, that's exactly right. I've got multiple aides telling me that Senate Majority Leader Mitch McConnell and his leadership team are essentially planning that if Democrats filibuster a spending bill, if the House passes it, gets over to the Senate, and Democrats don't provide the votes to get them to the 60-vote threshold that they actually need, the majority leader plans on keeping the Senate in session throughout the weekend. And as he does that, he's going to plan a series of incredibly difficult political votes, mostly targeting those 10 Democrats that come from states that President Trump won, in many cases very handily, that are up for re-election in 2018. Basically, it serves as kind of dual purposes here. It's a threat to Democrats who right now, John, I think you know this as well as I do, are very much so heading in that direction of keeping the majority leader from the votes he needs to get 60. So it's a threat, but it's also it kind of underscores the frustration here. There are pieces of this short-term bill that Democrats actually like, that Democrats very much support. And the fact that this is coming to this at this time is very frustrating to Republican leaders. So that's where we are. It's a standoff. It's people digging into their own sides. And right now, there's no real clear resolution forward with just 30 some odd hours left, John.